Hey everybody, thank you so much for watching. This is Cory from CoryBakerFilmmaker.com, and I just saw The Hunt, written by Nick Cuse and Damon Lindelof, and directed by Craig Zobel. So The Hunt is the little movie that wouldn't die. I mean, it originally was going to come out last year, but then there was controversy over whether it was appropriate because there had just been a number of mass shootings that had happened. And then news media started getting into the idea behind the movie, which is sort of like a leftist coastal elites hunting down right-leaning deplorables. And that sort of became a talking point on, you know, these right-leaning cable news shows. And it became tough to really give this movie a fair shake. And I think that's part of my overarching thoughts on this thing. I don't think it's offensive. At no point did I think that they were, like, doing anything that was so, you know, like, there's sort of, like, Florida Man and, like, other sort of, like, just general tropes. It's not offensive because of the characters' choices or the actions or anything like that. It's just more that all the characters feel hollow and that they're not, like, real people. And it's a horror movie, so I wasn't expecting Othello or anything like that. But it's hard to make any kind of huge overarching thoughts about the political ideology of this film, just because it's really not trying to go there. Not at all. And I think that's more part of my problem with this, is that it didn't feel like the sort of political nature of it was thought out well enough to how it would work with the movie. It sort of felt like they were trying to do a Purge type of thing, but more in terms of current left versus right ideologies. But it just doesn't, it's too hard to make a movie like that because there's so much that goes into why people on the left and the right are the way they are. And they touched on it just enough to try and go with it, but I mean, like, it's not strong enough to hold up the house that is the movie here. It's also never smart enough to, like, go up against any level of scrutiny. Like, it's again part of the inch deep and, or a mile deep and an inch wide problem. It just doesn't ever really seem to find its place, because it's just not as well thought out as it should have been to be such a center of attention lightning rod kind of movie. All that being said, it sounds like this is negative, but it's not. I really enjoyed this movie. It has, like, a lot of, like, cheap thrills and gore to make it really watchable throughout. And, you know, like, quarantining in place and staying in the apartment, it was a fun night. It just had a lot of action, and it kept moving along. And, you know, for a horror movie, it was perfectly enjoyable. It's fine. Horror movies are not usually put on such a radar as this one. So it's sort of like, it wasn't prepared for all this. If anything, this movie really did remarkably well, is it gave Betty Gilpin an opportunity to really shine. Now, I've been a big fan through Glow, and I think that this movie is a real star-turning vehicle for her. Now, the problem is does it get lost in everything? Are people watching this movie on demand? Because it lost out on its original screening window, and then it got moved to now, and then it kind of got lost again because of Corona. So now we're in this place where they're trying to salvage it any way they can, get some VOD action on it. And I mean, it's perfectly, this movie was built for VOD. This is the type of movie that I would have been really excited about if it, like, showed up on Netflix and we were trying to find something to watch. And I think that it was really wise for the studio to push it out that way, to make it available in home. And, you know, it kind of gives it more notoriety in a different kind of way as being sort of one of the first movies that really breaks the theatrical window. So even if it's not thought of in the long term as like one of these great horror movies, it's still sort of got like an interesting place in history. And I think the whole story of how we got from where it was originally about to come out to where it is now is like very interesting. But I mean, as far as the cast goes, like everyone does fine. I mean, Betty Gilpin is without a doubt the star of the thing. She does the heavy lifting. Everyone else does a admirable job or a fine job. Nobody steps out tremendously, but it's also a really small cast. It's only 15 people in the cast. So it's really, it stays pretty compact and it moves quickly, and Betty Gilpin is great, and there's not much more you can ask as far as acting in a horror movie goes. Overall, I think that if you're a horror movie fan, especially if you're a fan of the horror movies that Blumhouse puts out or Jason Blum is involved in, then you're probably going to enjoy this flick. Like, it's good. It's enjoyable. It's fine. It's really unfair, I think, to make it try and stand up to all the things that it was supposed to be. Like, when it got pulled originally, it was because it was too violent and the shooting was too much and blah, blah, blah. That is not... I probably would not have wanted to watch this movie if it was, like, the same day as a horrific shooting, but there's no way to, like, truly plan for that, and it just... It doesn't feel like it's neither here nor there. As far as the political aspirations of this film, it's... I feel like you get more in-depth analysis on, like, a CBS comedy or drama than you do in this movie as far as, like, political ideology and, like, an examination of that. It's just... It's not that movie either, and I think it's unfair to really paint it with that brush. And mostly I think it's unfair that it just never really had the opportunity to really show what it could do under normal circumstances without pressure or without outside attention on it. And honestly, the movie was just not built to stand up to that level of sunshine. And I feel bad for the filmmakers involved, like above and below the line. Because they deserve better than to have all these obstacles thrown in the way of this movie being able to just be released on a regular Friday night where nothing was going on and people could just take it as it was. Because I think everyone would enjoy it a lot more if it wasn't so beleaguered in controversy. Time to reload, because here comes the leaderboard. It's leaderboard time. Saw this movie at home, because I am a responsible citizen, and all the movie theaters are closed. So, just as a thing about that, like, obviously, I'm just going to be watching a lot of things at home. But I've also been thinking about sort of going into my collection of movies that I own on DVD. And I'm getting really into a new project, so I thought it might be interesting to sort of, like, talk about how when somebody is writing a project, how they might watch different movies to sort of glean inspiration from. So for the foreseeable future, I will be doing these reviews sort of without the theater leaderboard, because it just doesn't make sense to talk about all the things that I'll be watching on DVD at home and stuff like that, especially in a sort of change of format for a time being while we're going through everything that we're going through with the virus. Onto the movie leaderboard. Don't get me wrong, this movie is not a, you know, Academy Award nominee. It's a Fast and the Furious leaderboard type movie all the way. So this is largely irrelevant, this rating right here, because it's not what this movie, you know, as far as the actual art of the filmmaking and like what went into it and the performances and everything like that and script, I give it a 6.7. Like, it's neither here nor there. What you're really looking forward is the Fast and the Furious. Too furious. I'm too fast for y'all, man. Fast and the Furious leaderboard time. this movie's a lot of fun. I don't, you know, like, it's dumb, and it doesn't work, and it doesn't have a ton of great performances to write home about. It's just got Betty Gilpin just sort of, like, lapping everybody, but it worked. I mean, like, it doesn't work, but it works at the same time. It's fun. It's just enjoyable, and, you know, it's the type of movie that Blumhouse just is known for. They make them fast and cheap and easy, put them out there, and get enough money to come back to make the next one. And this one is really great for that. Like, it just does the job. It just it gives you a opportunity to sort of just hang out and watch a very aware of itself horror movie. And for that, the Fast and the Furious leaderboard, I give this movie a 7.7. Good time. Just, I don't know. It's enjoyable. It's unfair. At the end of the day, it's unfair. But nobody thinks about things, and it's just too many movies in the history of movies to think about all the ones that have been treated unfairly. Like, it sort of happens. It's breakage. This is just how the movie industry works sometimes. And I think that we'd be thinking about this movie a lot differently if it just got released and nobody knew about it other than the people who were looking for a movie to go see on Friday night. Anyway, that's it from me. If you want more, you can go to my website, CoryBakerFilmmaker.com, Facebook.com/CoryBakerFilm, and at LegendCB5 on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. Like I said, maybe going to be doing like sort of a new series where I talk about things that are like inspiring me in the process of writing a new project. So I'll try and record some of those and put them out. Obviously, if any other studios decide to do the Hunt route and release movies early on VOD, I won't be opposed to doing that as well. Obviously, new Netflix, Prime, that sort of stuff. Movies coming out. I'll be all over top of that. But in the meantime, please, everybody, stay safe. Stay home as much as humanly possible. We'll all get through this together, and soon enough, we'll all be back in the movies. And, yeah, that's about it. So, if you don't mind, I have to stay here. Just for the foreseeable future, stay here.